بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Tonight we'll be covering Easy Good Deeds 26 through 30, inshallah. We ask Allah to make this a beneficial reminder for all of us. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. So I'll list them out quickly and then we'll go through them one at a time, inshallah. 26, good conduct with the friends and relatives of one's parents. 27, good relations between husband and wife. 28, maintaining ties of kinship. 29, good treatment of neighbors. And 30, being cheerful and courteous. So starting with number 26, good conduct with the friends and relatives of one's parents, a practical way to kind of to work this in is, let's say someone, you know, they perhaps under normal circumstances, of course, everyone has a lot going on these days. We ask Allah to make things easy for everyone. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. So let's say under normal circumstances, somebody, you know, maybe they're at the masjid or they're at the store and they see someone, you know, one of their parents' friends, and they recognize them, and they greet them, they say salam, and they move on. They ask them, how are you doing? How's the family? And what have you. So what this is reminding us is to keep it in the back of our minds that in and of itself is actually rewardable. So you can have a dual intention, right? Intention number one could be to, you know, greet someone, to say salam to your fellow Muslim, for example. And then a secondary intention could be this, to be courteous basically towards the friends and relatives of your parents. We have a hadith here from Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhuma. He narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the greatest act of righteousness is that a person maintains ties with those beloved to his father. And it can be understood the father, the mother. I mean, it depends on the person. It depends on, you know, the dynamics at play. What's explicitly mentioned here is the father. But let's say there's maybe a daughter who's, you know, who is in touch with like her mom's friends, you know, those aunties, and that would be, that would be rewardable as well, inshallah. And you notice something here that when the Prophet mentions, alayhi salatu wasalam, the greatest act of righteousness, this is something that magnifies it. And you notice in different instances, there are different examples of people asking the Prophet, like, what's the best deed in Islam? What's the best deed for me to do? Asking the Prophet for advice. The Prophet, he would respond, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, with the best advice for that person. So multiple people may ask the Prophet the same question. What is the best deed for me to do? Or what is the best deed in Islam? And the Prophet, he responds relevantly, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in a way that's most suitable for that person, that is best for that person. So here, the Prophet is highlighting, being good to like the friends of your parents is actually something rewardable and, something that's very good, mashallah. Moving on to number 27, good relations between husband and wife. We have a beautiful hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Again, this is from the book Easy Good Deeds by Mufti Taqi Osmani. You can get it online for, I think, maybe $10, $15. Definitely worth it. This would be a good book to kind of have as a family halaqa, even if it's like a virtual Zoom family halaqa, something that works for you and your family, whatever works best and is safest. We ask Allah to keep all of us safe and to protect us and our loved ones. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. Here, number 27, good relations between husband and wife. So the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, it's mentioned here that he said, the most perfect of believers in faith are those with the best character. So here the Prophet is mentioning the importance of good character in general. And then the Prophet narrows it down to something specific. So first, the most perfect of believers in faith are those with the best character. The best of you are those who are best to their wives. So in general, good character, and then specifically towards the spouse. Here what's mentioned is the Prophet is advising men to be good to their wives. So you have the importance of Islam being lived at home, right? You have the importance of balance in Islam. So this reminds us that there should be this balance between the vertical and the horizontal, having a good relationship with God, and then the horizontal would be being good towards God's creation. So here what's specifically mentioned in that regard is to be good, for the men to be good to their wives. So good character in general, so the balance, right? Praying is good, mashallah. Reading Quran is good, mashallah. But that's supposed to impact how we treat God's creation as well. So if someone is praying and praying and praying, but then they have horrible character, then that's problematic. That would be a paradox, you could say. That doesn't add up. Something is not adding up, because if someone is praying often, if someone is praying consistently in general, and then especially if it's in the masjid, then ideally that person should have really good character, right? Their character should be from among the best character. But if they're praying all the time and then they have bad character, then there's a clear disconnect there. We ask Allah to protect us from that. So the Prophet is highlighting here the importance of good manners, the importance of good character in general, and then specifically at home towards, for men to be good towards their wives. And of course, it's also important vice versa for the wives to be good to the husbands. So there should be balance in that regard. This is not supposed to be a hadith in which, it's only looked at as a one-way street, that, you know, one spouse has to be good to the other. It's understood that it's a two-way street. One should be good to the other, and the other should be good to the one, for example. There's also a narration here. So underneath where this hadith is mentioned, it says here in the commentary, the hadith mentioning the reward for the morsel a husband places in his wife's mouth has already been cited. Another hadith mentions reward even for conjugal relations between husband and wife. Some of the companions asked, O Messenger of Allah, one of us fulfills his desire and is rewarded for it? He replied, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, tell me, if he were to fulfill it through unlawful means, would he be sinful? So if he fulfills it lawfully, he will be rewarded for it. So you have the importance of living Islam within the home, the importance of sadaqah, you could say, within the home, good character at home, you know, kindness at home. On the next page, it mentions here, and again, we need to understand that these different action items are regarding generally normal situations. These are not regarding situations of abuse. These are not regarding situations of like extreme circumstances. This is regarding the general realm of normality. We have an ayah is cited here from the Quran, in which Allah says, if you dislike them, then it is quite likely that you dislike something, and Allah has placed a lot of good in it. A lot of good in it. Surah Nisa, ayah 19. Again, this is to be taken in context. This doesn't mean that if someone is being abused by their spouse, well, you know, there's other good stuff about them too. Abuse crosses a line, and if that line is crossed, then naturally that changes things. And these are not supposed to be things that are quoted to people to justify abuse, right? That's absolutely horrible. We ask Allah to protect us from that and from that misunderstanding. Underneath the ayah, it mentions here, there's a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No believing man should despise a believing woman. If he dislikes one of her qualities, he will surely like another. So the Prophet is highlighting here that, you know, find a silver lining, try to find something positive in the situation. And this is something that goes both ways. Again, in a generally healthy situation, in a generally normal situation, because naturally, even in, say, a good marriage, even in a healthy marriage, there's still going to be different arguments that come up and different disputes that come up and different issues that come up. So this is general advice that, you know, don't forget about the good in the other person, right? And the other person should not forget or overlook the good within you. Again, in a generally normal and healthy situation, we ask Allah for peace and happiness and all kinds of goodness in all of our homes, Amin Rabbil Alameen, and for anyone dealing with any struggles within the home, any struggles within their marriage, it would be highly advisable for them, even if it's one of them, ideally both of them, to go to counseling, to go to marital counseling, to go to marriage counseling. Ideally, they would go to that together. And if one is not willing to go, then at least the other should still go and speak with a therapist, speak with a counselor to at least get their advice regarding their situation. That time and time again, that has proven to be, provided it's a good therapist, a decent therapist, ideally the best of the best would be a really good therapist who's also Muslim, because then they would have the general understanding of certain cultural nuances and certain norms within general Islamic culture. So that would be the ideal situation. The best of the best would be to speak with a really good counselor who's also Muslim, right? That way you get the best of both worlds, inshallah. Light upon light, as they say. Moving on to number 28, maintaining ties of kinship. Good conduct with one's relatives is known as silat al-rahim, an action very beloved to Allah Azza wa Jal, and for which He grants abundant reward. The noble Quran enjoins maintaining ties of kinship in many places and has stated its virtues. Again, we need to understand that this is regarding a generally healthy situation. This is not regarding situations of abuse. And I feel the importance, the need to give that disclaimer, because oftentimes these same ayahs and hadith at times are taken out of context, and unfortunately at times are mutilated to justify abuse, which of course is highly problematic. So just a quick disclaimer, a little asterisk, that, you know, this is regarding generally healthy situations. So you have the norm, and then you have, I'll give you an example of an exception regarding this. So for example, also in Surah An-Nisa, Allah mentions, and be good to parents and to kinsmen, وَبِذِ الْقُرْبَى, those close to you in terms of your blood relations. Absolutely, this would be, again, so think of norms and then think of exceptions. Think of like healthy situations and then unhealthy situations. These different ayahs and hadith have to do with healthy situations. An example of an unhealthy situation that in practice technically goes against this, but we need to understand it properly, especially because of who it's regarding. Allah says regarding the Sahaba in general, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, radiyallahu anhum wa radu an, in many places in the Quran. One place in which Allah says this, that Allah is pleased with them and they're pleased with Him, is at the end of Suratul Mujadala or Mujadila, Surah 58 in the Quran. The last ayah is a bit of a lengthy ayah, and within the ayah Allah mentions radiyallahu anhum wa radu an. You also find in Suratul Bayyina, radiyallahu anhum wa radu an. Allah is pleased with them and they're pleased with Him. That's regarding the Sahaba, the companions in general. Now, out of all of the companions, you have a special, think of like an all-star team of 10 companions, a special group of 10 companions in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and he mentioned all of them by name. Imagine being one of these individuals to be alive. And for the Prophet to tell you himself that you are guaranteed Jannah. If you knew that, if you were told that, how would you react? How would you respond? SubhanAllah. So the Prophet mentioned that Abu Bakr is in Jannah, radiyallahu anhu. Umar is in Jannah. Uthman is in Jannah. Ali is in Jannah. Right? And the Prophet, he mentioned other names as well. And one of the other names is that of Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. My point is, he's a very special companion. So the companions in general, very special generation. The Prophet said that the best generation of Muslims are my generation of the companions, radiallahu anhum. May Allah be pleased with all of them. So you have the generation of the companions, and then out of them you have this very special group of 10. And out of them I'm highlighting one, who, by the way, later on he would become the head general in the army other than Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. This is Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. He actually, if you look at things historically, he actually killed his father in battle. This was one of the battles between the Muslims and Quraysh. I forget if it was Badr or Uhud. I believe it was Badr. And Abu Ubaidah, great companion, not only a companion, a great companion, right? Very special companion. He actually killed his father in battle. Now, does that mean that he was going against this ayah, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ حُسْنًا? No. Why? Because these were exceptional circumstances. So you have, again, healthy situations, and then you have unhealthy situations. That was clearly an unhealthy situation. Right? So just for us to understand that these different ayahs and hadith need to be understood within context, especially when it comes to dealing with family members. Because very unfortunately, you have a lot of different cases, a lot of different situations and scenarios in which there can be a ton of abuse within those different dynamics. And unfortunately, people may go and say, well, you know, there's this ayah, there's this hadith. Imagine if somebody were to go to Abu Ubaidah and to tell him after that battle that, you know, you made a huge mistake. Allah says you have to be good to your parents. Surah Isra, for example, is a Meccan surah. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Yes, in healthy situations, absolutely. But you look at unhealthy situations, that's an example of that. And I've mentioned previously, like Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, you find this in Surah Maryam, Surah 19, which is literally named after Mary, peace be upon her, the mother of Jesus, peace be upon him. In that surah, in Surah Maryam, you find these verses in which Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, he's inviting his dad to Tawheed. He's trying to get through to his father to invite him to worshiping God alone. And we need to understand that his father, his primary business was to make idols and sell them. So Prophet Ibrahim, he's trying with amazing adab, amazing kindness and love and respect. Ya Abati, Ya Abati, Ya Abati, one ayah after another. Oh my beloved father, oh my beloved father, oh my beloved father. Pristine adab, right? So he, think of it this way, he has the best product, so to speak, in terms of business terminology. He has the best product in terms of Tawheed, in terms of Islam. He's also an amazing salesman, right? So it's not just about the product, but both. It's about the message and also the messenger. It's about the message and also how that message is delivered. If the message were to be delivered with harshness, then people would turn away. And what they're actually turning away from is not even necessarily the message. Rather, if there's harshness in a messenger, we're not talking about prophets and messengers with a capital M. For example, you and I, like lowercase messengers of the messenger, right? And this goes back to the conversation that the Prophet had with Mu'adh when, you know, he's going to Yemen. How are you going to judge according to the Quran? Okay, what if you don't find it in there? Then according to the Sunnah, what if you don't find it in there? Then, you know, then I'll use my judgment. And the Prophet praised Allah for giving him, for providing him with good messengers on behalf of the messenger. So it's not just about the product, but also about the salesman, also about the approach. Anyways, Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, he's doing his best to get through to his father. Amazing kindness and love and respect and adab. There has to be adab when it comes to da'wah, and Prophet Ibrahim is an amazing example of this. He's trying to get through to his dad. Yes, he's trying to deliver the message, but with amazing kindness and compassion. Ya abati, la ta'budu shaytan. Ya abati. One time after another, to the point where his father told him, if you don't leave me alone, I will kill you. Leave me alone. So Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, he left him alone, right? Why? To protect himself. That was an unhealthy situation. So Prophet Ibrahim had to protect himself from the unhealthiness in that situation, right? So it's not a one size fits all type of thing. It depends on the details of the situation much of the time. So these are regarding norms, yes. In healthy situations, yes, absolutely. But then what happens if it's unhealthy? Then it's to be dealt with accordingly. Bi-idhnillah. Prophet Ibrahim, he leaves his dad to protect himself. He was at risk because his dad was threatening him, his health, his well-being, his life. So he said, okay, peace out. Like, I'm going to go do my own thing. And he never saw his dad again after that. Would anyone accuse Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam of cutting ties with his father? No. Why? Because he was protecting himself. You have to look at the context of the situation. Anyways, elsewhere in the Quran it states, so the ayah that's mentioned here, and be good to parents and to kinsmen. So this chapter title, this easy good deed, is maintaining ties of kinship. Elsewhere it states, fear Allah wa taqullaha alladhi tasa'aluna bihi wal arham, fear Allah in whose name you ask each other for your rights, and fear the violation of the rights of the womb relations. Wal arham, the rahm, it refers to the womb of the mother. And you find even within that term for the womb, it directly relates to rahmah, mercy. So within ties of kinship, there should be a sense of mercy. And if one person crosses boundaries and abuses the other person, clearly the opposite of mercy, right, oppression, then things would have to be dealt with accordingly. And we ask Allah to protect all of us and our health and our well-being. Amin Rabbil Alameen. We have a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in which the Prophet said, whoever believes in Allah in the last day should maintain ties of kinship. We have of course you have more context and, more points should be kept in mind. Like, just because someone's sibling, for example, just because someone's brother or sister tells them, hey, go do this, and if it's something bad, then you tell them no. And if they say, oh, then I'm not talking to you and whatever, and the emotional blackmail and what have you. No, you have to hold your ground. Not that it's easy, but the priority essentially would be Allah in that case. If they're telling you, hey, go do this bad thing for me because I'm your sibling, then in that case, as much as you love them, right, you would decline. Let's see here. Okay, moving on to number 29, good treatment of neighbors. Allah has given neighbors many rights. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Jibreel alayhi salam continued advising me regarding the neighbor until I thought he would deem him an inheritor. Abu Shuraih radiallahu anhu narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever believes in Allah in the last day should be good to his neighbor. In another narration from Abu Hurairah, whoever believes in Allah, who narrates that the Prophet said, whoever believes in Allah in the last day should not harm his neighbor. Right? So we shouldn't be, playing the whatever may be on TV full blast at like 2 a.m. Right? Why? Out of courtesy to neighbors. So we should be careful in terms of how we treat our neighbors. And there are different components to it, as was mentioned here. On one hand, to be good, and on the other hand, don't be bad, right? So there's don't harm your neighbor, and then in addition to that, to be good to your neighbor. And if you don't know your neighbor's names, maybe take the time to introduce yourself, maybe exchange names with them. If you have, maybe fruit trees that are in season, and you have a bunch of extra fruit, whatever the season may be, I think now it would be peaches and other fruits as well. So if you have a peach tree in your backyard or your front yard, and you just have a bunch of extra peaches, maybe fill up some bags and go give them to to your neighbors to share, you know, just to, even if you leave it at their front door maybe, and leave a note saying that, you know, this is from so-and-so, you can leave your name and, you know, what your address is, just so they know who gave it to them. By doing that, you're living your deen, and you don't have to give them a pamphlet. Instead of a pamphlet, what's better than that is peaches. Give them peaches or whatever fruit is in season, apples or oranges, you know, based on the time of year. Avocados are very expensive, very valuable, mashallah, to share with them. Right? And it doesn't matter if the neighbors are Muslim or not. Just the Prophet is saying, what? If you're Muslim, then be good to your neighbor. We ask Allah to make us good neighbors and also to surround us with good neighbors. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. Moving on to action item number 30, being cheerful and courteous. A very famous hadith from the Prophet ﷺ. And actually, Mufti Taqi Osmani, may Allah preserve him, may Allah bless him and his family and grant them the best of this life and the next. May Allah gather them in Firdaus, Ameen Rabbil Alameen. He's actually the author of this book. And he mentioned in a lecture, you can find the video online, you can find it on YouTube. If you look at Mufti Taqi Osmani, Easy Good Deeds, he gives a talk as to what inspired him to write this book, to put this book together. And he mentions that this hadith was one of the motivating factors in which the Prophet ﷺ said, do not consider any good act inferior, even if it be to meet your brother with a cheerful face. Subhanallah. Especially because you never know what someone else is going through. So just by you smiling, maybe that makes their day. Maybe they are just feeling horrible, and it's like the worst day of their life up until that point. And you happen to come across them. I mean, if you have a mask, then you know you wouldn't literally be able to see the smile, but you get the idea that you know, even if you're on a Zoom call with a family member, with a friend, because you know, in that context you would have to have your mask on. And maybe just by casually smiling, maybe that impacts them more than you know. Right? You don't know, you may not know what someone else is going through. So the Prophet is telling us here, again, do not consider any good act inferior. Sometimes a person may think, you know, what's the point of donating a dollar? It's not $1 million, it's not $100,000, it's not $50,000 or $30,000 or $10,000, whatever. So what's the point? What difference is $1 going to make? What's the Prophet saying? The Prophet is advising us to adjust our attitudes, if that's what it is. Do not consider, because he said what? Any good act. Shay'a. Like any good act. Literally anything. Do not consider any good act inferior. Even if it be to meet your brother with a cheerful face. Subhanallah. What if that singular, rather small good deed is your ticket to paradise? What if that in and of itself gets you into Jannah? Right? Didn't the Prophet teach us the value of bringing, after the obligations, bringing happiness to a fellow Muslim, bringing happiness to a fellow believer? Right? The Prophet, he taught us the best thing after the obligations is to make another believer happy. This is not a small thing. So what if you smile and that makes them feel a little bit better? And maybe they think to themselves, because of, and you may not know this, but maybe because of that smile, it gives them a ray of hope, a ray of sunshine that kind of peaks between the clouds. And maybe that inspires them. Maybe that affects them. Maybe they feel like, you know what? Because you never know what's going on inside someone. What if within themselves, and they didn't tell anyone this, what if they told themselves, they made an internal decision that, you know what, I'm going to go through my day. Let's say these are under normal circumstances. And let's say they made a promise to themselves, within themselves, and no one else knows about it. And if they think to themselves that, you know what, if no one smiles at me today, let's say someone thinks this, if they think that no one smiles at them that day, then, you know, they're going to harm themselves, God forbid, or they're going to, you know, commit suicide or something. The struggle's real and these issues are real. And you have stories of people who, there was one man who, he attempted suicide by jumping off the Golden Gate Bridge. He told himself, if no one asks me how I'm doing today, then I'm going to walk off that bridge. He didn't tell anyone. He made that intention within himself. Unfortunately, no one asked him how he was doing that day. He went to the Golden Gate Bridge and he jumped. And we need to understand how high that is from the water. I mean, landing on that water from that elevation is comparable to like landing on concrete. Right? May Allah protect all of us. So he jumps and, you know, he crashes into the water. And subhanallah, a seal came and held him up until someone noticed him or a lifeguard noticed something, somehow someone noticed that he was there. And so help was sent and he was literally rescued and saved and he survived. And after that experience, he said that as soon as he jumped, he thought to himself that this is a mistake. Subhanallah. And miraculously, I mean, he had broken bones and a lot of pain and agony, but he survives. And so later he would comment that as soon as I jumped that, you know, I immediately regretted it. So he ends up surviving and then dedicating his life to helping prevent others from committing suicide. He dedicated his life to suicide prevention in others. Subhanallah. My point is, within himself, he didn't tell anyone, no one else knew. Within himself, he decided if this doesn't happen today, then this is what I'm going to do. And he was serious about it and he actually went and attempted it. So imagine if perhaps in a similar situation, someone thinks to themselves that, you know, if no one smiles at me today, then they're going to go and do the same thing. What if your smile, you don't think anything of it? What if your smile that day is the only smile they see? And because they saw your smile, that one smile, maybe no one smiled at them before that, and maybe no one smiled at them after that. But they made this promise within themselves that, you know what? If someone smiles at me, then I'm going to live to see another day. Then I'm going to, you know, I'm not going to commit suicide. And instead, I'm going to, you know, figure something out. What if your smile, what if that's the lone smile that they see that day? And as a result, that saves their lives. You're rewarded for that. فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Subhanallah, Allah says in the Quran that if you save one life, if you save one innocent life, then it's as if you saved all of mankind. And you just did that by saving that person's life with one smile, and you don't know anything of it. You didn't know that they made that intention within themselves earlier, that was something they were going to do. Subhanallah. Now you see like, oh wow, you know, all of a sudden a smile is not just a smile. Right? Excuse me, of course these days it's, you know, it's a bit tricky because of, you know, people are typically wearing masks. Maybe there's some kind of a work meeting, a Zoom meeting, and maybe at some point you smile within that that meeting, that conversation. What, you never know. There could be a coworker who had that thought process. And what if, you know, you smile and that saves their life that day? That saves their life, period. And then maybe they, you know, speak with the therapist and, you know, maybe they speak with a psychiatrist and maybe they take medication, maybe whatever. I mean, the point is, what if that one seemingly small act makes a huge impact on them? And then what if they go and they turn their lives around and then they get involved in suicide prevention? And maybe the like the motto of the organization or something, is, you know, smiles save lives, for example. And you have no idea, and maybe you notice that you hear the organization one day and it's like, oh wow, you know, this former coworker of mine, they went and they started this organization and they're having a fundraiser, and so you donate, even if it's a dollar, hopefully more, but $1 is good, alhamdulillah. And they have that tagline, you know, smiles save lives. And so they go, and you have no idea that you are directly responsible for all of that good. And what if they go and they save dozens and hundreds and thousands of lives? And it has a serious impact on society and even the world. Unbeknownst to you, you're getting just mountains upon mountains of good deeds, right? So we should really reflect about this beautiful hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. SubhanAllah, the Prophet's vibe sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so positive that people continue to smile until today because of him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah help us to learn more about the Prophet, and may Allah increase us in love for our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Moving on to the, because I have to conclude here. Moving on to the next narration that's mentioned here. Abu Darda radiallahu anhu narrates that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there is nothing heavier in the servant's scales on the day of judgment than good character. Allahu Akbar. Allah despises an obscene, vulgar person. The next narration, the most perfect of believers in faith are the best of them in character. The next narration, a believer attains through his good character, his or her, of course, through his good character, like mankind, it literally says mankind, but it includes both men and women. Anyways, a believer attains through his good character the rank of one who is constantly fasting and standing in prayer. SubhanAllah, look at the value of character. The next narration, and we'll conclude with this, inshallah. Amongst the most beloved to me, the Prophet is saying this. None other than the Prophet himself. Let that sink in. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Al-Habib himself, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, said, amongst the most beloved to me, among you, and those sitting closest to me on the day of judgment are the best of you in character. SubhanAllah. So this clearly shows us that our deen is a deen of balance. Because on one hand, you have Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, a great scholarly companion, asking the Prophet, what's the best deed in Islam? And the Prophet said, to pray on time. So that's on one hand. No doubt that's important. But then you also have, so the balance between, think of it this way, the balance between the five pillars and good character. We ask Allah to make us from among those who have good character, from among those who are cheerful, from among those who are courteous. We ask Allah to also surround us with those who have good character, who are cheerful and courteous. We ask Allah to make us people who smile. We ask Allah to guide us and to forgive us. We ask Allah to accept our efforts and to overlook any and all of our mistakes. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما صلى الله عليه وسلم. We ask Allah to make this book and what's mentioned within it proof for us on Judgment Day and not against us. أمني رب العالمين. For anyone who has difficulties in general, we ask Allah to turn those difficulties into ease. For anyone who has any general difficulties, we ask Allah to turn them into ease. And for whoever has specific difficulties as it relates to within the home, within their families, we ask Allah to also turn those hardships into ease. We ask Allah to grant us peace in our homes. We ask Allah to grant us nur in our homes. We ask Allah to grant us happiness and safety and protection and stability in our homes and our families. Amni Rabbil Alameen. We ask Allah to help us to be good neighbors, and we ask Allah for good neighbors. We ask Allah to guide us and to forgive us. We ask Allah to gather all of us in paradise in Firdaus, Amir Rabbil Alameen. Subhana Rabbika Rabbil Izzati Amma Yasifun. Wa Salamun Ala Al Mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.